Gwendolyn is such a straight trivet. Oh, her mother is such a Gorgon. You know, I've never seen a Gorgon in my life, but I'm pretty sure that she is one. Oh. You know, she is absolutely a monster without being a myth, which is rather unfair. Oh, I beg your pardon. I shouldn't talk of your aunt like this, dear Algy. In that case, anyway. Red Veil.
Since dear Uncle Jack first confessed to us, the younger brother who was very wicked and bad, you, of course, have become the chief topic of conversation between myself and Miss Prism. And of course, a man who was talked much of is always very attractive. One feels there must be something in him after all. I dare say it was foolish of me, but I fell in love with you. Worn out by your entire lack of my existence, I determined to end the matter one way or another. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you under this dear old tree here. I remember only too well I had to write your letters for you. I wrote always 3 times a week and sometimes oftener. The 3 you wrote me after I'd broken off the engagement are so beautiful and so badly spelled that even now I can hardly read them without crying. Well, wouldn't have been a very, really engagement if it hadn't smashing.
Well, I must say, Algernon, that I think it's about time that Mr. Bunbury decided whether he's going to live or die. This shilly-shallying with the question is absurd. Nor do I approve of this modern sympathy with invalids. I consider it morbid. Illness of any kind is not a thing to be encouraged in others. Health is the primary duty of life. I'm always telling that to your poor uncle, but he never seems to take any notice as far as any improvement in his ailment is concerned. Well, Algernon, if you are obliged to be beside the bedside of Bunbury, I have nothing more to say, but I would be much obliged if you would ask Mr. Bunbury from me if he would be so kind as to not have a relapse on Saturday, for I rely on you to arrange my music. It is my last reception, and one wants something that will encourage conversation, especially at the end of the season when everyone has said everything they want to say, which in most cases isn't very much. Staccato.
No, there is
is a notorious domesticity for the name John. And I bet anyone married to a man called John. Melting.
Yes, a bumbrist. Well, I was quite right to say you're a bumbrist. In fact, you might be the most advanced bumbrist I've ever seen. You have invented for yourself a younger brother by the name of Ernest. So that you may come into the town as and when you please. I have invented for myself a perfect invalid by the name of Bunbury. Bunbury is wonderfully invaluable. Why, if it weren't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, I wouldn't be able to dine with you tonight at Willis's. Because I've already been previously engaged with Aunt Augusta for over 1 week. But I have no intention of dining with Aunt Augusta. Depressed cookie dough.
Apprised, sir, of my daughter's sudden departure by her trusty maid, whose confidence I secured by means of a small comb. I followed her immediately by a luggage train. My husband, I am glad to say, is under the impression that she is attending a more than usually lengthy lecture by the university extension scheme on the value of a fixed income on thought. I have never undeceived him on any point. I do not propose to undeceive. It's wrong. But you must clearly understand that all communication between you and my daughter must cease immediately. On this point, as on all points, I am firm. Stick.
The simplest intention of doing anything of the kind. To begin with, I dined there on Monday, and once a week is quite enough to dine with one's own relations. In the second place, whenever I do dine there out now, I'm always treated as a member of the family and sent down with either no woman at all or two. In the third place, I know whom she shall place me next to. She shall place me next to Mary Farquhar, who flirts with her own husband across the dining table. That is so bad. Indeed, it is not even decent. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husbands is perfectly scandalous. It is simply washing one's own clean linen in public. Besides, now that I am a confirmed bumberist, I naturally want to talk to you about bum burying. I want to teach you the rules. Jack Daniels and Coke.
Algis and a brother. I have a brother after all. I knew I have a brother. I always said I have a brother. Cicely, how could you doubt that I didn't have a brother? Dr. Chesbull, my unfortunate brother. Miss Prism, my unfortunate brother. Gwendolyn, my unfortunate brother. You young scoundrel, you will treat me with more respect in the future. You have never behaved to me like a brother in your life. Lost.
The truth is rarely pure and never simple. Modern life would be very tedious if either. And modern literature a complete impossibility. Literary criticism is not your forte, my dear fellow. You should leave that to people who haven't studied at the university. What you are is a Bunburyist. You are one of the most advanced Bunburyists I know, for you have created a younger brother, Ernest, in order that you may be able to come into the town whenever you like. Likewise, I've created a perfectly valuable invalid named Bunbury, in order that I may be able to go to the country as often as I like. How perfectly invaluable invalid Bunbury is! But if it wasn't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, I wouldn't be able to dine with you and Willis's tonight, for I've been engaged at Augusta for more than a week. Atmosphere of panic.
For me, was to speak to us. It's my first time in my life that I'll be just such a very good position. And I really quite inexperienced doing anything kind. However, very frankly, Dad, I have no brother Ernest. I have no brother at all. I never had a brother
life. And I certainly haven't smallest intention of ever having one in the future. Rhythm, stillness.
Is as straight as a trivet. As far as you're concerned, we are married. Oh, and her monster is absolutely her mother's absolutely unbearable. Unbearable. You know, I've never met a Gorgon before in my life, but I'm quite sure that she is one. In any case, she's quite simply a monster. Without being a myth, which is rather unfair. Oh, but I apologize, Algy. I shouldn't talk of your own aunt in this way before you. penetrating.
Say, Algernon, that I think it's high time Mr. Bunbury decided whether he was going to live or die. This shilly-shallying with the question is absurd. Nor do I approve of this modern sympathy with invalids. I find it morbid. Illness is not a thing to be encouraged in others. Health is the primary duty of life. I'm always telling that to your poor uncle, but he never seems to take any notice as far as any improvement in his health concerns. Well, Algernon, if you are obliged to be at the bedside of Mr. Bunbury, I have nothing more to say. But I'd be much obliged if you would ask Mr. Bunbury from me if he would be kind enough not to have a relapse on Saturday. For I am relying on you to arrange my music. It is my last reception, and one wants something that will encourage conversation, especially at the end of the season, when everyone has said practically what they have to say, which in most cases is probably not much. All.
What you are, sir, is a Bunburyist. I was quite right in saying you're a Bunburyist. In fact, you might be the most advanced Bunburyist I've ever seen. You have created for yourself a younger brother by the name of Ernest so that you may come into town as and when you choose. I have created for myself an invaluable invalid by the name of Bunbury. Bunbury. Wonderfully invaluable. Why, if it weren't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, I wouldn't be able to dine with you tonight, so what is this? Because I've already been previously engaged with Aunt Augusta for over a week. But I have no intention of dining with Aunt Augusta. Personal atmosphere, bubbling champagne bubbles.
Ha 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 ha
glad. You, of course, have formed the chief topic of conversation between myself and this prism. And of course, the man who is often talked about is always very attractive. One thinks there must be something in him after all. I dare say it was foolish of me, but then another thing, I guess. The engagement was actually settled on the 14th of February last. Worn out by your entire ignorance of my existence, I determined to end the matter once and for all. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you under this dear old tree here. Floating.
Daughter's son flight by her trusted maid, whose confidence I secured by means of a small coin. I followed her at once by a baggage train. My unhappy husband is, I'm glad to say, under the impression that she is at a more than lengthy lecture by the university extension scheme on the influence of a fixed income on thought. I do not propose to undeceive him. In fact, I have never undeceived him on any question. I would consider it wrong. But you, sir, must clearly understand that all communication between yourself and my daughter must cease immediately from this moment. On this point, as on all points, I am firm. Lust.
Intention of doing anything of the kind. To begin with, I dined there on Monday, and once a week is quite enough to dine with one's own relations. In the second place, whenever I do dine round there, I am always treated as a member of the family, and sent down with either no women at all, or two. In the third place, I know whom she will place me next to. She will place me next to Mary Farquhar, who always dines across the diner table and flirts with her own husband. That is not very decent. Indeed, it is not very pleasant. That thing is enormously on the increase. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husbands is perfectly scandalous. It is so bad. It is simply washing one's own clean linen in public. Besides, now I know that you are a confirmed bunburyist, I want to talk to you about bunburying. I want to tell you the rules. It's not coming home. Devastation.
Well, ever since dear Uncle Jack first confessed to us that he had a younger brother who was very wicked and bad, you, of course, the chief topic of conversation between myself and Miss Prism. And of course, a man who's mushed, talked about, is always very attractive. One feels there must be something in him after all. I dare say it was food.
the matter one way or another. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you into this dear old tree here.
I remember only too well. I had to write your letters for you. I wrote always 3 times a week and sometimes oftener. The 3 you wrote me the day I broke off the engagement is so beautiful. So badly spelled. Even now I can hardly read them without crying.
The truth is rarely pure and never simple. Modern life would be very tedious if either. Modern literature complete impossibility. Literary criticism, not your forte, my dear fellow. You should leave that to people that studied at university. But you are as a Bunburyist. You are one of the most advanced Bunburyists I know. You have created a perfectly invaluable England named Ernest in order that you may be able to come to the country as often as you like. How perfectly invaluable invalid he is. Likewise, I've created a perfectly invaluable invalid named Bunbury in order that I may be able to go into the country as often as I like. How perfectly invaluable he is. Like, if it wasn't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, I wouldn't be able to dine with you at Willis's tonight. For I've been engaged in Augusta for more than a week. Atmosphere of love.
Frankly, Dad, I have no brother at all. I never had a brother in my life. And I certainly have the smallest intention of ever having one in the future.
Jack. No, there is very little music in the name Jack, if any at all.
Indeed.
Been more than usually plain. Besides, Jack is a notorious domesticity for the name John. And I pity any woman married to a man called John. She would probably never be allowed to know the entrancing pleasures of a single moment's solitude. The only really safe name Ernest.
Day.
be a stylish marriage. I can't afford a carriage, but you'll look sweet upon the seat of a bicycle made for two.
One more round.
One more round.
Yeah.
Feather.
Feather.
I always said I had a brother. Sicily. How could you ever doubt that I didn't have a brother? Dr. Chesbull? My unfortunate brother. Miss Prison? My unfortunate. My unfortunate brother. You young scoundrel. You will treat me with more respect in the future. You have never behaved to me like a brother in your life.
Daisy!